Hi there, my name is Mark Downey. I'm a program manager on the Visual Studio Production Diagnostics team. And today I'd like to talk about recognizing and diagnosing sync over async issues in your applications. Asynchronous programming has been around for several years now on the .NET platform, but has been historically been very difficult to do well. Async await concepts were introduced in C# 5, and since then, asynchronous programming has become incredibly popular. Today, most modern frameworks are fully asynchronous, and it's frankly nearly impossible to avoid the async keyword when writing web services. Today, I would like to go over some of the best practices to avoid sync over async, and more importantly, show you how to recognize the anti-pattern in production and use Visual Studio to avoid these problems when developing and updating your code. So today I'm going to show a couple of really common examples of how we can do asynchronous programming badly. And we're going to start with this first action on this controller. This is a prototypically bad way of dealing with task.result. And frankly, task.wait has the same type of issues. So using task.result or task.wait to block wait on an asynchronous operation is actually worse than calling a truly synchronous operation. So let's look at what's going on in here. I have an action on this controller that is calling into this service, and this is an asynchronous call to this method. In fact, if we do a control F12, we can see that it's doing simply a random and waiting for some period, wait representing a database call or some other request to a service, and then we're returning some result. Control minus to go back to our action. And because this isn't set up for as an async await, I have to do a dot result in order to make this compile. It seems like a reasonable solution here. The problem, when we take a look at this from a big picture standpoint, what's happening here, while this will compile and it will run locally and it will probably run in production under low load, as we get higher load, there's gonna be problems, and I'll describe why. An asynchronous operation has been kicked off essentially from here. But the important thing is that the calling thread is blocked waiting for the operation to complete by using dot result. So when the asynchronous operation completes, it will unblock the code waiting on that operation. But this operation is taking place on another thread. This is what we mean by sync over async. The result is that we now need to use two threads concurrently instead of one to complete what is essentially a synchronous operation. From the perspective of your end users and your customers, there's a whole bunch of symptoms that are coming here because we are essentially going to starve our thread pool. So the leasing mechanism for deciding which threads are going to execute which code, that whole leasing mechanism becomes starved. That will lead to long process times for your running applications and your requests. It'll lead to timeouts. It will have your customers asking why everything is so slow. And again, this typically only occurs under load. So as you're developing locally, you'll never see this. And then when you have reasonable load on your servers, you probably won't see this. So this phenomenon will result and manifest at the worst possible times. There are unfortunately lots of ways to get this particular pattern wrong. If we dive down a little bit here, we see another example. This time we're using a task run in combination with get awaiter and get result. Unfortunately, comes to the same unfortunate predicament. Here's another example with task run with a few more get awaiters, but it ultimately comes down to the same problem. Let's go all the way to the bottom, to the right way to do this. In this example, this final example, in this action, I use the async and await keywords. I wrap my result in a task. Then now, as you can see, I no longer have to have a result or a wait for this operation, and I can return the result immediately at the bottom of this method. So a reasonable question is, what actual difference does this make to an application running in production? What we was able to do was set up a series of tests where we run under similar load for our good code and what is essentially our bad code. The two pieces of data I want you to focus on in this .NET counters results here, we're looking at system runtime statistics here, and the two pieces of information that are really important are thread pool queue length and thread pool thread count. The thread pool queue length is really important in that it demonstrates how many requests are actually waiting to even be executed. So over time, the thread pool queue length is increasing. The second really important one is the thread pool thread count. Essentially, if we see this increasing, we know that the thread pool is having to add new threads to manage the increasing load against your application. Seeing the thread pool queue length as long as it is and increasing to as much as a depth of 60 tells us that we have 60 requests that are not currently being serviced. So looking at this again with the same load, but with the code now corrected to use async await correctly, our thread pool queue length remains at zero, meaning there are no requests that are waiting to be serviced. And in fact, our thread pool thread count, the active thread count, stays relatively low. In fact, almost half of what it was before. Again, this is typical for scenarios where our services are running correctly. And when it's running incorrectly, we tend to see an increase in the thread pool queue length. And we tend to see the thread pool thread count increase over time. So in addition to using .NET counters to validate the state of the thread pools, you could also take a memory dump using another CLI tool like .NET dump. That memory dump would contain sufficient information for us to kind of analyze the state of your application in a safe way in Visual Studio. So here I'm going to go ahead and hit Control O and open up a memory dump that I have captured earlier. And I'm gonna go ahead and run diagnostics, which is one of the actions you can take here. Running diagnostics allows me to start a diagnostics within Visual Studio, and then I can get access to a bunch of tools that might be helpful to me in this context. So because it's a process responsiveness issue, the symptoms we are likely to encounter would be my application isn't responding quickly, or there's too many timeouts. So process responsiveness would be a great option for us to look at. I'm going to go ahead and analyze that. And immediately, it detected a couple of things. First is that the thread pool threads are out of threads, meaning it hasn't got the opportunity to respond or to add new threads, which takes several seconds to do. So that's a first indicator that there's something wrong here. We've starved our application of the ability to execute additional work. And more importantly than that, it's detected that there is actually a sync over async issue here, that in fact, we have run out of threads to, not only have we run out of threads to service our requests, but we've identified the code and the call stack that is also problematic here, where we are synchronously waiting inside an asynchronous context. And then we can use this tool to kind of dig deeper into this problem. So while those are the tools to capture this issue in production, there are tools that allow you to capture this issue earlier in your life cycle. So I have the same application open here, and obviously I have multiple areas where I've done this incorrectly in my application. And what I could do is actually apply code fixes and refactoring powered by analyzers to help me while I'm in my IDE. So while I'm developing my code, it will tell me straight away that I'm developing something with an issue. And if I can just apply this to even existing code. So I can go to tools, go to NuGet package and manage NuGet packages for solutions. I can then search for Microsoft Visual Studio threading analyzers. And this threading analyzer can be installed against my existing project. And what this does is it takes advantage of the .NET compiler platform, which is Roslyn. And there are several analyzers listed in here that allow me to understand where my app has has kind of gone against a standard way of doing a particular thing. And now I've kind of have that familiar squiggling green line telling me that I have some problematic code. And in fact, it's able to detect every single one of the anti-patterns that I have described here. And if you link, you can click on the links and get additional help specifically about each of these and why they're problematic. In today's session, we looked at best practices to avoid sync over async issues. We demonstrated and discussed how you can detect sync over async in production using .NET CLI tools, and we concluded with tips for using Roslyn analyzers to help detect and avoid the issues in the code in the first place. Thanks so much for joining.